this week's episode featuring Carrie Hart.
Fuck Carrie Hart.
Also, Jason, you alluded...
I hear me say fuck Carrie Hart to his face on Ellistronics. And then we fight. But you're not going to know about it unless you go on Ellistronics podcast. I don't know, but is that like a way to promote podcasting? I don't know much about podcasting.
It's the anti-promotion. I like it.
Okay, don't go see it. We fight. He might not be alive.
That's right. While you're not listening to Ellistronics, also don't listen to the Birdcast.
Right.
Yeah, do not listen to mine. Mine's gotten good lately.
Okay, wait. Well, mine's got really... Ellis Chokes has got really good, and I have a Speedo on in it the whole time.
He sandbagged us.
Hey, right? That's some bullshit.
Highly of your podcast. Hey, Bird Crusher, how you been?
What's up, guys? How you doing?
I put on 45 pounds. See my Ellis Chokes podcast.
You look fantastic. Yeah. Last email I got from you was, hey, man, are we cool? Do you remember that?
Yeah, of course I do.
You're like, I stopped partying. I just want to make sure we're cool. And I was like, I'm always cool.
I'm super paranoid at the best of times. And I feel like I'm going to, man, I shouldn't even say this, but I feel like the comedy world has shut me out. And I feel like all comedians don't like me.
What?
Yeah, that's why I checked.
Why? That's fucking crazy.
I feel like SiriusXM. Here's my conspiracy theory. I've been going down this wormhole lately on YouTube where Ari Shaffir doesn't like Howard Stern. And I remember that Opie wasn't cool with me for a while because I was hanging out with Stern. And then there was this whole thing. I went down the wormhole of when Stern and Jimmy and Opie, I never caught that. I knew they hated me and they said some bad shit. And I didn't have a problem with it because I was crapping on about being the best guy in radio. Like it was a fucking running race. And, because of my insecurities, but they were like, you know, what is he kissing Howard Stern's ass? He ain't gonna get anywhere. Stern doesn't give a fuck about anybody, and he's absolutely right. He doesn't give a fuck about anybody. And I was like, not that nice to him. And he loves comedians. And then Joe Rogan won't talk to me. There's this weird thing where he has no comment. That's his opinion of me. No comment. And I know what that means. That is the professional higher level of handling someone that you want nothing to deal with. You don't say why you don't like him. You're just like, yeah, he's cool. We've never got any time to be on each other's stuff. He doesn't want anything to do with me. So I'm like, Opie doesn't really like me. Joe doesn't really like me. And they're both like the kings of like comedic fucking podcast radio. So that means Bert doesn't want to hang out with me.
Bullshit.
And who else did I think? Doug Benson doesn't like me. And
Bert, did you tell Tom Segura not to come back here?
Yep.
Why did Tom not come back? No.
Yeah,
Tom,
I just
Tom named his son after you.
What?
His son's name's Ellis.
No, he didn't. Anyway.
I always tell him that. I was like, man, you must have had a great experience on the Jason Ellis show.
Wait, his kid's name's Ellis?
All right, maybe I shouldn't say that out loud. I don't know. Some people are weird about their kids.
Wait, his first name?
His first name's Ellis. His last name's Dante. Show. Yeah.
That would be very flattering.
The entire family.
I do that too, though. I do that where I get into a spiral and I start. My manager one time. I'm not my manager anymore, but he said something to me one time. He's like, I had a bad set, and I was like, we need to get back in front of those people. I did poorly, and that's not representative of how good I am as a stand-up. And I was freaking out over it like 2 days later. And he was like, Papa, I think you're overestimating how much people think about you. And I was like, really? And he goes, who have you been thinking about for the last 2 days? I was like, me?
Yeah.
Because that's who they're thinking about themselves.
Yeah. Look, I understand that too. I really do. I've even said that on the radio before. And as I just stated to you, it's paranoia.
Yeah.
But it's, I feel like when I first got into this game, I spracked off, and it's like a confidence builder from an insecurity. Like, no one's going to blow me up. I'm going to blow me up.
Yeah.
And then when I become good, then I'll tell you that I told you so. I don't know any other way to get good at stuff.
Yeah.
That was just how I used it. But I feel like from therapy and all the other things that I've gone through recently, I am like, man, fuck. I mean, I'm fucking annoying to people. Like, Ari Shaffir... I didn't even know that there was a thing with Stern. I had no idea.
Well, that thing with Stern has nothing to do... That has to do with the fact that Stern thought podcasting was bullshit.
He said some very stupid shit.
Yeah, Ari is the most opinionated... like, shoot from the hip, but I thought about it in the shower, opinionated guy. Like, I saw him go on a radio show one time, and they're like, who are you going to vote for? And he's like, I'm hoping someone goes out and kills both of these people. That's the only way to make change. We need someone to kill people. And you're just like, that's like, that's crazy talk, but that's Ari.
He's angry, huh?
Well, he's an interesting guy. You know, he started as a Hasidic Jew.
What? I don't know what a Hasidic Jew is.
The dreadlocks. Not dreadlocks.
Oh, yeah?
You know, yeah. And the yarmulke.
Yeah.
And, like, only hung out with his people. And hardcore.
And then he fell out.
Gave up his God and found drugs. Wow. And he's like, and he is, man.
Because his Twitter, he tweeted me because a fan said something to him about Attack and Stern. Mm-hmm. And he was like, you're irrelevant because this thing happened 2 years ago. And then I was like, he ain't talking to me, is he? And then, like, no, he's talking because there's my paranoid brain again. But I was going to say, hey, I'm not mad at you. I like him, you know?
Ari's great. Ari's great. You would love Ari.
He's been on here.
Yeah.
He was going to fight at Ellis Mania. I like that guy.
Yeah.
I just, when you bash Stern over and over again and you're in podcasting, yes, he did bash podcasting. And look, he is in his 60s. He doesn't pay attention to shit anymore. He's more into what he's into.
Yeah.
Just like you will be when you're his age. But you can't deny that he fucking made it for all of us, even podcasting. Not a professional. Because he did sound stupid saying you don't even know how to do something that nobody needs to do anymore. But he talks freely and he doesn't go, blah, 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 I've got a radio voice thing. So he invented all of us.
Yeah.
He invented my job. And I'm old school because I'm not in a podcast. Well, I am in a podcast, but I just started. We've had 6 episodes. That's how fucking late Johnny Come Late we are.
Yeah.
But it's talking in a way where you talk how you really are. And guess who invented that? He did.
Yeah.
So, yes, he's a tad clueless when it comes to his podcasting a big thing. Because, I mean, I'm well aware of people making millions and millions of dollars out of podcasting. And it's weird that he doesn't know that. But I also think, man, if you make $100 million a year, you could be out of touch with... You might still think that dudes that make $10 million a year is not real money.
Yeah.
It's insane.
And he's a friend of Carolla's, so you'd assume he'd know.
But that's the other rabbit hole that went down. Bert Kreischer was when Adam Carolla was there, and Ari Shaffir was in the room with another SiriusXM host, and Ari was about to tear Stern a new ass, and Adam was like, look, you work hard, and it doesn't matter what medium it is. Like, you know, as they say, they eradicate terrestrial radio. If you've got a following and you work really hard, you keep your head down, you'll pop up somewhere else. That's all I know. Yeah. And it was like, and I'm like, I strive to be you. Because I think the only thing I have a problem with it when it comes to Howard and Opie and Ari is that you give that much of a fuck against them. You know what I mean? Like, when I used to think Bubba the Love Sponge would say some bad things about me, and I would leave here, because I remember somebody out here said, you're not allowed to say anything bad about Bubba anymore, and he was on talking to my friend Dan Henderson saying what a bitch I was, and I'm like, you know where I come from? I'll fucking punch you in the head, cunt. Like, that's where I'll fucking come.
Yeah.
And now I'm being told by my bosses that control my livelihood that I need to shut the fuck up or I'll be fired because he told them to tell me that.
Yeah.
And I was fucking pissed. Like, I'd be spending hours thinking, I'm going to fucking get you one day, dude. You'll see. You'll be fucking sorry. And that, you know, and then I'm scheming. Like, I'm going to make the show gigantic. And now I'm making the show gigantic, not because I'm enjoying the show, because I'm going to get that fat motherfucker back and I'm going to make him pay. You're going to get fired and I'm going to be on top. And then you're going to suck my dick, motherfucker. Like, no, I don't want to be in that, because I remember it was, I mean, people would say, you know, my kids are like, what do you want to do, daddy? I'm like, daddy's busy right now, in my own head, stewing about fucking a fat dude over. Like, stop, Jason. Like, don't do that. So I don't want to be a part of, because I'm in the RDs talking shit on how I don't want to be fired and then go on your podcast and say, you know what I mean, I always hated so and so, because Opie made it amazing. Opie and Anthony did something incredible to me. And some people are like, I've never heard of them. I'm like, well, they're the second biggest radio show in the world to me.
Yeah,
they rivaled the Man, and the Man. I might be getting cancelled from the Man. I was going to be on there next week, and I got told yesterday that he might be bumping me from being on the Stern Show because there might be an A-list celebrity that's coming in, which to me tells me that I'm getting bumped. okay, so I'm getting bumped from the biggest show on SiriusXM. Would it have helped me to be on there? Yeah. It would be cool to be back on there. It's a fucking... You would do it. It's cool to be on there. Right, so... That's like... I'm fucking Stern. Fucking cocksucker. All he cares about is A-list celebrities. No. Suck a dick, Alice. You're not a fucking A-list celebrity. Eat one and move on with your life. I don't hate that guy. There's like, he doesn't pay people enough. Well, fucking, I don't know. Go to school, get another job. It's not... I can't hate that guy. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for that guy. Same as all these other dudes.
I listened to the Artie thing with Opie. I think Artie brought up a lot of good points for diehard Stern fans. I never was a diehard Stern fan. I was a Johnny Come Lately. So for me, what I really loved out of Stern was like he has the ability to interview someone that I have no interest in whatsoever and make them fascinating. Like he interviewed Aaron Carter and his brother Nick Carter. I remember driving down a mountain road going, God damn it, these guys are fucking amazing.
See, I disagree that was his ability. As I've just... Look, I'm saying he's one of the greatest, if not the greatest interviewer, but to interview the Carter brothers, you've got yourself a gold mine. Seriously, those are gold mines.
Really? Are they?
Fuck, are you kidding
me? See, I had no interest.
They are insane.
I saw they live like... They live like on the island, like Bloodlines. You ever seen Bloodlines on Netflix? Oh, I'm fucking obsessed with
it. Wait, they live... I've never seen that either. I never clicked on it. Is it good?
Oh, it's good.
Okay, I will click on it.
Especially if you're from Florida. I know you're not, but those guys live on an island in the Keys, and like...
They do?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Still?
I don't know. I'm sure the money's still held up. They bought property in like...
Wait, together they do?
I think the whole family does. And they have like ATVs that drive them from house to house, and they just own the whole... island.
What?
Really? I know. This is
news to me. Because there was a sister, too, who took a crack at pop stardom.
Yeah. They had a reality show for a second. And
the little one is... I've always wanted to punch him in the head. But like, not... I wouldn't actually do it.
Yeah.
But he's always been like, if somebody sort of punched him in the head and it was on video, I would chuckle.
Yeah.
Kind of face. He has that face where I'm like...
He's got to hate Justin Bieber. Your head. Justin Bieber took his entire career.
I never thought... Well, I don't think... See, I never thought Nick Carter was actually good.
Wait, which one's the little one?
Aaron's the little
one. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, Aaron.
But like Nick, for example, I bet if you get a couple in him, he might have a few choice words about Justin Timberlake. Because it was NSYNC against Backstreet Boys, and each had the clear transitional, you know, solo star. And I was working in pop radio when Nick put out his solo. It was terrible.
Yeah.
And then Timberlake delivered... Like I Love You, which is like a classic hit. Like,
isn't
you
that
can't
just
hate Justin Timberlake for being more talented than you.
Right, exactly. Because that's I would just say that Justin was just way better. Because like, I didn't want to like NSYNC or any of them.
I didn't want to like terrible. Justin Timberlake at all.
But Justin Timberlake's album was good.
And it's the same thing with Aaron Carter and Justin Bieber. You can't be mad at Justin Bieber for
Justin Bieber turned a corner.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. Like, I met you, I met you. You know that song?
No.
You got kids that are into it? Is that how you know that?
I give you the key when nobody else was drinking.
Can you play whatever the fuck Bert's trying to tell us?
Can you just play the karaoke version so Bert can keep singing?
That song?
I don't know it.
I heard it one night, and I was like bobbing my head, and in my head, like immediately my brain went, I could do some ecstasy. Like, and you know what song's good when you go right to drugs.
No, I like where pop music is right now,
because
it is very ecstasy. The Where Are You Now song with the
little... That's the one I'm singing!
Okay, yeah.
Yeah!
No, it's not.
That's what we did!
No, we gotta...
No, I'm not. I'm thinking... You didn't just hear me sing the words?
Yeah, I like this song that you're playing. What's this?
No, that's not what I was singing.
Why is Come Todd so frustrated right now?
Earworm. I know.
I love that. Yeah.
I really connected with that.
Yeah, you're not connecting with me at all.
I played that when we did last year at the end of the year, our favorite songs of the year.
Here we go. Is this it?
I'm sitting at a club, and I don't go to clubs much.
Wait, you were sitting at a club?
I was at a club with young people.
Wow.
Yeah, and I just was like,
is this for the TV show?
No, it's just sometimes you get caught up in a tsunami, and you just end up doing young guy shit as an old man.
Did you do ecstasy?
No, but it was there. And the song starts playing.
Great, Bert, you did a little ecstasy. I know,
it was so fucking obvious. You're a shit liar. Man.
I know. It's going to affect your kids. You didn't take anything. It's cool.
It's called Molly now. It was Molly, and they had sarsaparilla as well. Was it sarsaparilla?
Sarsaparilla.
Is it that you take it with it? No, not.
Oh, wait, what?
Succotash.
Sarsaparilla is like what Bugs Bunny used to drink in the old West.
I swear to God, I think it was sarsaparilla.
That's a drink, right?
No, it was the root.
Oh, wow, they gave you the root?
This part hit.
Yeah, I know.
And I was like, okay, I could just go off the rails for a night, mm-hmm. right? Cheat on my wife.
Wait,
go
what?
Go fucking just nuts. I'm not a dad tonight, I'm Bert. Bert's a young guy, he's got a life full ahead of him. Here we go. And I'm just going fucking nuts. And I was like, I get it.
There's a thing inside of me that the system and the man and wife and kids can never take away from me. And that is the realest part of me.
Fuck my remodel. I'm getting a motorcycle.
That's real.
Yeah.
You just too. Made me like Justin Bieber.
I know. I got.
Hey, we need to play this song. It's a great song.
You want to know the even better songs?
Yes, I do.
Because I bought 5 of the remixes.
Wait, the remix gets better?
They make remixes that are even better than this song?
You know what? That's crazy. I do believe that because the best remix, Hot and Fresh Out of the Kitchen, the remix is better than the original.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. There's if you just type in the remixes, any of the remixes, they get even better and better and better.
Wow.
So I have all of them. I get on the, I'll go, oh, I love that commercial.
Okay, now I'm getting thrown off.
Yeah. But wow. this one's good.
This is the marshmallow remix.
I love marshmallows.
Me too. That's the shirt I'm wearing in the promo for my special.
Wait, you're wearing it just...
It says marshmallow.
Oh, okay.
Dude,
I know. I was really alienated by pop music, and I didn't expect it to ever come back around to something that I could like. And you're not the only adult I've spoken to who feels this way, that pop's having a little moment right now that I'm like, good for you kids.
Oh, hell yeah. Music's in a really good place.
Yeah, I disagree with that.
There's this kid, Vince, not Vince Carter, he sings North North. Do you know North North?
Okay, yeah. He's a rapper. You might have lost me now.
Yeah. I saw him on this thing, and I was like, I haven't been connected to hip-hop in a while.
Yeah.
Like, last time I was really into hip-hop was like, Tupac, Biggie, when I was really connected. And yeah, in New York, when I was there. But there's this kid. Tell me if you don't love this video, just as in Vince Staples.
I don't think I've heard the original.
I don't love it.
I just think
but he pulls back and he's in a cop car.
So?
I don't know.
I just heard the version of this where the
suburban. He raps with, like, he's getting arrested?
The suburban mom reads the lyrics and cries.
Oh, I haven't seen that.
To me, this is glorifying going to jail.
Yeah.
That's a bad idea.
That's what the crying mom had to say about it.
Oh, for real?
Yeah. No, it's telling the kids that it's not so bad to go to jail. And then you ruin the rest of your life, Bert, unless you want to be a comedian, but is everybody as funny as Bert Kreischer that you can see at...
Sure, at the Funny Bone in Dayton, Ohio.
For my birthday, I'm throwing a surprise party for myself on the 3rd.
Are you going to do Molly again?
I don't know.
See, I think it's weird. When I first got divorced, my dear friend Dingo... who is not here, he was supposed to be yesterday, but I think he partied so hard this weekend that he won't be on until Thursday. But Dingo gave me some Molly, I'm an alcoholic and stuff, so that was my window coming back, and it took me 4 years to get sober again, but I never like just went completely bad shit because I got a career and stuff, but...
Yeah.
That particular event, he was like, you know, just a little bit of Molly, and I'm like, man, I don't do like hard drugs. I'm scared of that stuff now because of the back in the day I used to do a lot of it. And he's like, this stuff's pure
MDMA,
so you won't do anything to your heart or anything. It's just like it'll just get you just feel good. So I did some MDMA, and then Chucky was attached to the roof, and he came over and gave me a giant bottle of Belvedere in this nightclub. Like, he was attached to the roof, and he flew across the roof.
Like Sandy Duncan?
Like Child's Play, Chucky.
Like Sandy Duncan and Peter Pan? attached to the roof?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Shut the fuck up, and gave me
an extra large bottle of Belvedere, and this blonde girl was making out with me, and then I blacked out, and then I guess what I didn't know, but Dingo was putting more Molly in my drink all night. So I was having a really good time. And then I woke up in Dingo's bed with two chicks. One was, you know, when things started to pop off, and one was like, whoa, that's, I'm not a threesome chick. And so I guess I'd accidentally made my choice. So I hooked up with some black chick, and she was hot, and it was awesome, and it was such a great time. And then there was this emotional fall for like 4 days after.
After that?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I'm...
Were you married? Not at the
like
time?
It. No, I got divorced. No, because I have a chemical imbalance, dude. Like, I can't do drugs and alcohol. You're okay. Like, you drink a lot and you have a good time. You go up, you do your stand up. And
I'm punitive.
What's that mean?
I'm punitive with myself.
What does that mean? I don't understand.
I have what I call it the Mickey Mantle gene. So, like, I go out, I party, but I get up at 6 in the morning and I go to CrossFit or I do what I wear a run. I say to myself, I hear it in my head. I can hear the voice in my head going, oh, you want to be a party boy? Get the fuck up. It's time to go to work.
Right.
You don't get to take the day off. You don't get to have a pity party.
Yeah, well, see, I don't have the mental stability to do that stuff. Some people do, some people don't. It doesn't work for me. So yeah. I bounced on the whole scene.
It's good. I'm glad you did. You look great.
I feel way better.
I look at your Snapchats and I get jealous because I go, he seems really happy.
Yeah, he's lying.
Hey, would I be allergic to your cat?
What? No, it's that they're cats that they're for people that get allergic to cats. My fiance is allergic to cats. That's why we have bald cats.
Are you fuck? Ah, damn it.
So, wait, do you get allergic to cats?
Yes, and we got a cat
because of the cat hair.
Yeah.
Yeah, get the bald cat and you won't be allergic to it because she has allergies to normal cats.
God, I'm gonna have to unload that one you got though.
Dude, I've tried.
You could shave it over and over again.
Shaving a cat can't be easy.
try telling the cat that.
almost killed a cat this morning.
What?
Yeah, there was a black cat, and it was very dark when I left this morning, just chilling in the middle of the road, obviously injured. And it was only that there was a lady walking dogs who kind of yelled to me to stop that I realized.
Aw, did she help the kitty?
Eventually, the kitty, I think, kind of three good-legged
crawled
away. Yeah.
Wait, did you stop the car to get out to kill it?
Yes, I was like, I keep a bat in my truck for these.
Like, nobody knows where you're putting it out of its...
It's called, yes, it's called, it's engraved on the bat is out of its misery. Yeah.
No, at first I thought that the cat was just giving me attitude before I realized that it was not right.
That makes
sense.
And
then there was a guy behind me who was beeping at me to move. Well, he didn't know why. Maybe he thought I just paused to have a conversation with one of my neighbors, not knowing that I hate my neighbors.
Yeah. No, you gotta save the kitties.
Yeah.
So, you're not as fat as you usually are, too, right? Have you lost some weight or something? Your jacket?
It's my jacket. I've been fluctuating.
That's what you do?
Yeah. What happens is if I quit drinking, I go for little chunks of not drinking.
Okay.
And then when I stop drinking, usually it's when I'm home.
What's a chunk?
I don't know. Anywhere from like 3 days to 3 weeks.
Okay.
Like 3 days. Like, as I'm on the road, and when I'm on the road, it's really hard not to drink. Because as soon as you get on the road, everyone's buying you shots.
Yeah.
I mean, and so when I'm on the road, I'll drink. And I drink on planes.
Is Tom fatter than you?
Yes, as much.
That feels good, right?
Oh, God, yeah.
I noticed Tom has his podcast, Your Mum's House, which is funny because I've been using that one for some time. So now he's ripped off of a podcast name and a child named after me. So it's good to see that I've influenced him. But he did have a guy on YouTube that he interviewed that I find very entertaining. And it's funny because I saw him and was like, I've got to get this guy on the show. And then realized that Tom has already had him on a show and challenged him to a fight. Have you seen this Asian guy that like loves boxing? Crazy Lokes is probably one of the most interesting people on the planet today.
You haven't seen this?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh.
Crazy Lokes has got some sweet videos. Originally he had a sweet video. I think he's in a supermarket. And he's spracking off to the camera. Yeah, this guy right here.
This is in a supermarket.
Yeah. Yeah. He's mentally disabled, right?
I asked Tom. I was like, are you really going to box him?
You can't punch a dude in the brain with that brain damage in the first place.
He's crazy and lokes already.
So look at that sparring. Look at that sparring. Look at that.
He's got elbows. He's coming from all different angles.
He is one of the greatest rappers alive.
He does do a freestyle.
Oh, he sure as hell does. If you get a freestyle, Andrew, so that the listeners can understand Crazy Lokes and his freestyle capabilities. But he did spar us. He does fight people, right? I mean, he has fought people with boxing.
He's got a manager who owns a burger joint in Northern California. That's his manager, I think. Because I've talked to him on Twitter.
Okay.
Because he jumped on Team Burt very quickly when Tom and I went to that fat-shaming war. And I think they made some videos, and I got excited. I go, Tom, are you going to fight the guy? And Tom's like, he's really actually crazy, Burt. I can't fight him.
Well, it's crazy, because if he's crazy, you can fight him. But if he's mentally disabled, you can't.
I think he might be mentally disabled.
Okay, because I went down the rabbit hole on his YouTube account, and I would say, yeah, do the one where he's doing the push-ups, because that's very... He's doing push-ups on the couch, and then he freestyles. But he kind of... I think he thinks that he can freestyle, and he can't. But he makes up words. Split spit.
Please fall.
He's doing a split in his living room.
Okay, that'll do.
Wow.
You know, it's funny because
you've seen that before.
Never seen that.
You should invest in that, Andrew. Notice how he only uses like one actual real word every now and then. The rest of it's like jokes. Just do it. Just let it go.
Never get stuck like a screwdriver.
I don't have a problem with your freestyle there, but
it's such an odd way to do a split.
I know he's an odd man, but it's
on a railing.
No, it looks like he's trying to get
in a lazy boy
fucked in the ass from behind while he's rapping
on a railing in a lazy boy.
Whose house is that? The poor bastards.
Oh, it's his parents.
It's gotta be, right?
It's definitely his parents.
Step one, think of the richest guy I know. Step two, let me film something in his living room and pretend it's mine. There's always been. It's like a definite strong strain of crazy, the egotistical crazy guy, the crazy guy who thinks he's the shit. This is just the first era in human history where that guy can kind of back it up and get YouTube views and get kind of really as big as he thinks he is in his crazy mind.
He kind of missed the boat on American Idol. He could have been like an American Idol superstar. You know, what was
I
that
love
weird?
That you used the analogy, missed the boat for him.
I did not mean that. You're the racist that caught that joke. Yeah, he could have done well, I think. But you don't talk to him anymore. Or
who?
Thomas left Crazy Lokes alone. They've separated.
I guess I've talked more to Crazy Lokes and his manager than I think Tom has, and I wasn't involved in any of it.
How was the conversation? Did you have a conversation with Crazy Lokes?
It's always through DM.
Oh, okay. Can he spell?
I don't. I think I'm talking to his manager.
Oh.
There's a video where you can find him and his manager. I think they're working out of the back of a van.
Yeah, they're calling Tom, right?
I think so. I'm not sure.
I went down the rabbit hole.
The one thing that disturbs me about Tom is Tom's ability to find shit like this online. Like, he finds stuff, like, 4 months before anyone sees it, and then, like he's almost like a honeypot for crazy. Like, he introduced me to Diantword. I've never heard of Diantword.
Yeah.
And he was like, sent me an email or something, and I looked at it, and I was like, and then I became obsessed.
They're terrific.
I'm in love with Yolandi Foster.
I know.
I'm in love
with her. So is Telly. Telly always has been.
Oh,
just keep on releasing the same song over and over and over, and I love it every time.
Yeah.
She is like 40, and she's like, please, Ninja, can I stop doing this now? And he's like, nope. We got another new album.
Look, it's there's worse jobs to have.
I know.
Yeah, there is totally worse jobs to have.
You pretend you're a little weird African bunny rabbit.
It's just funny to still be playing, like, essentially jailbait when you're a mother and you're in your 30s.
She's your mom?
They have a kid together.
Yeah.
They're together?
Yeah. Wait, you didn't know that?
No.
That's a business, son.
Oh, shit.
What did you think it was?
Yeah.
I thought they were an art house band from South Africa, and they did this, but he had a separate life, and then she had a separate life.
I don't think it's as much of an act as you think it is.
For real?
Which is kind of
so poor. Those are real tattoos.
For real, though.
Those are real tattoos.
I believe those are his real
tattoos.
Wait,
what?
Yeah.
Are you fucking serious? You think it's painted on?
Yep.
You're out of your mind. That's a real dude that's really like that all the time.
No.
We tried to book them on
yes,
the
it
show.
Yes, it is.
I can't believe it.
We tried to book them on the show years and years ago, and their management was basically like, they're playing in Pomona. Do you want to book a date with them? We'll do it. Is he going to show up? I don't know. But we'll put it on the books. We'll do that. Like, getting
really?
Him to travel 40 miles, like, anything could happen on the 10 between here and there.
Okay, that blows my mind. Like,
you like him more now, right?
Yes.
It's way better, yeah.
Because it's like
I
there's
can't believe
a,
you didn't know.
But there's a genre of, like, riffraff and action Bronson, where you don't know if they're playing characters. Action Bronson's pretty real. But, like, riffraff, I didn't know if that's a character or not.
Isn't riffraff real, too?
I thought it was a character.
No, he's really like that. He got MTV tattooed on his fucking neck. He's really that dumb.
Maybe there was a separation between the guy and the character a while ago, but I think those lines have been blurred for about a decade.
So is that... That's fucking crazy.
He's
those
so fat now because these steroids are like gone backwards on him.
I love it.
He can't keep up the fucking bench press. He's like too busy smoking weed and drinking scissors. And now he's like just fat and like... He's got like manicured beards and shit. That guy's a P-tard.
What was their piece of shit movie, Chappie?
I saw
Chappie. Hey, fuck you, man.
Look at him.
Look how many roids he did.
God, he looks like my buddy Hank Brown so much.
It's so crazy. And now, look.
He looks like Nick Lachey went for Halloween as Riff Raff.
Yeah. What's crazy is now he's just a big fat guy with tattoos. Because he's not... He looks like Hulk Hogan now. These are like 5 years ago, these photos. This is where he shredded. And now he's just like... Because steroids makes you eat a lot. Like, it makes you hungry.
Really?
Yeah. Cause that's like part and parcel. Like, it's easy to lift more weights, but it's like your body desires more food,
yeah.
And is ready. If you don't answer it though, like if I just did steroids, I will get way bigger everywhere, but I'll get fatter. You start bench pressing, then you turn it all into muscle. I mean, that's how a skinny guy gets big, is he has to eat tons of food, tons of carbs, tons of protein, and he benches like a motherfucker. Look at it.
He looks a little fat.
Look at that.
He looks a little fat.
I'm sorry, but I'll laugh at that all day.
I would have stayed skinny if I was
there. No, it's a way better... Dude, as a bigger guy, that is, like, to me, it's... I have to stay on it all the time or I get fat.
Good God.
Yeah.
Who would choose to get that... Who would choose to get big?
Who would choose to get MTV tattooed in their fucking throat, Bert Kreischer? You're out of your fucking mind. Who would choose to be on a hip-hop dating TV show, Bert Kreischer?
Yeah.
This guy is a fucking mega tool.
To me, the getting big thing was he just felt like he constantly needed a new wrinkle to keep people talking about.
He's an innovator.
I assume that's what that was.
Has to be.
And you gotta respect his hustle.
Wasn't there some talk of him dabbling in professional wrestling?
And Hulk Hogan started to catch on that he was out of his balls. He makes beats, and that's how he made his money, too. Like, he made beats, not so much a good rapper, but more of a... At one point, people were using him to make a beat. Sort of like...
Diplo?
Fucking... Nah, what's his name? Rob Dyrdek's cousin. Drama. Drama makes beats for rappers because he was on Ridiculousness. Or on fucking Rob's...
Fantasy
big,
Factory.
Big World, yeah.
See, now Rob Dyrdek is someone I can't tell where reality blurs with him.
Oh, that's him.
That's him?
Yep.
Does he drink?
Mm-hmm.
He does?
Yep.
Oh. Like, because I found out that Robin Big was scripted, and I kind of bummed me out, because I always believed that was real.
Well, I mean, scripted as in they would say, let's go do this and let's go do that, and write it down, and like, what about if I say that I've got a man pun in my ass and shit like that, but
yeah.
Like, the interactions are off the cuff.
Yeah, Rob Dyrdek's an interesting fucking guy.
That guy is, for me, he was an inspiration to me because I knew back in the day when skateboarding, you could make money out of skateboarding, but he made 10 times more money out of skateboarding than anybody else because he wasn't just like, give me a check for skateboarding. He was like, I want a piece of this, I want to design that. He was designing half of DC shoes, so he was making a check off everyone else's shoe, not just his, and the shoe that didn't have a name on it. Like, he was an entrepreneur before any of us.
You knew him before, right?
Yeah.
Are you still friends with him?
Yeah.
There's
got a baby interview. Now. Got a baby. Got married. Met her on fucking Twitter. Hilarious.
Really?
Yeah.
He did an interview with that I saw. I don't know where I saw it online, but it was a 4-part interview, and it was fucking fascinating. And it was his. It was talking about
smart dude.
He's a really smart fucking guy.
He pitched all those TV shows. He had like all episodes all planned out. He didn't. I mean, you got a TV show. You know how hard it is. He didn't just say, yeah, man, I'm a fucking interesting guy. Give me a TV show. Go. He had, like, here's what this will do. It'll branch into this. It'll branch into that. He made fucking Ridiculousness before Tosh, O, and all that stuff. It's just it got picked up later. But he pitched that way before those guys.
Now let's go back to where we started this conversation.
Okay.
Me and you are very similar, and you start wondering, do people hate me? It's a low self-esteem kind of obsessive compulsiveness. Rob Dyrdek does not have that at all. He's got the Kevin Hart gene, which is, and I'm not shitting on Rob. Kevin is my friend. I'm not shitting on either of them, but they believe they're great. The interview driving in here on the radio was with DDP, and he kept saying, if you repeat something enough, you start believing it, and the world starts believing it. That's how Muhammad Ali became the greatest.
Yeah.
So, Rob Dyrdek, it's like, how do you get the self-esteem, the confidence to say, I'm gonna do what no one is doing? How do you become Kevin Hart and you go, I'm selling out arenas? Because I would say humble. Humble's not the right word.
I think you're worried about other people's opinions.
100%.
That's what mine is. Because as I said at the start of the show, when I was talking to you, that's how I got good at skateboarding, because I believed that I could do it. And I remember I was like, I'm going to be the fucking best dude in the world. And people were like, you're out of your mind. I'm like, I'm going to get out of Australia and I'm going to be a top 10 pro skateboarder. The difference was, when I got really good and I started to realize around other people, I'm going to be way better than everybody on the ramp. And then when I cannot come off the ramp, I should probably try to dumb it down a little bit so that I can be more like the common man. And that was my first mistake, I swear. Because I was like, yeah, I'm not that good. I mean, I fuck up every now and then. Like, I wish I could have done that better. But, you know, coming from a retard, it's the best I can do. Thinking that would make me... And that psychologically, I'm starting to, like, put a chink in my armor.
Okay, this is what I do. I do this hard fucking core. Because there's no way I will ever walk off a stage and go, I am the best comic that was on that stage tonight.
Right.
I will never say that? I never say that out loud. Sometimes, right. Sometimes I go,
that'll do.
Yeah, that was, yeah, but if someone says, how were they? I go, oh, you never know. Like, I'm never a guy that goes,
yeah, okay.
I destroyed it.
So you're trying to be humble, and it's sort of, it's a fine, like, to me, it's the insecurities. You're talking to yourself. I feel like Rob and Kevin Hart are very similar I think those are two good analogies of what they're doing is the key way to do it. I don't know if they're content with everything they do because of living that life that way. But, for me, in radio, I did the same thing. I Conor McGregor'd myself. Before Conor McGregor came out, I was on here wanking on about how I'm going to be the fucking future of radio. I will destroy anybody. I wish it was a running race. I wish it was a fight so that it would just be flat out obvious that I fucking won. But I have to fucking wait my turn and it's bullshit and blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
Give me an interview and I'll tell you that I'm number one on SiriusXM. It's just nobody's putting me on the same track as these other guys. Asshole. Well, if I'm Opie I know Howard wasn't listening because he doesn't care, but Opie was. And Opie's like, you're fucking talking about you're the best dude on Sirius. So you're better than me? I've been here for 30 years and you're pissing on me? I'm not pissing on you. I'm not trying to piss on you. I'm trying to pump up my insecurities. If I think I'm better than you, I could have just thought I was better to you to myself. It didn't help me get the show bigger. If I tell everyone on the radio I'm the best dude in radio when you're listening, that doesn't make that person tell his friends, you've got to hear this guy, he's the best in radio.
So what was Rob Dyrdek like when you'd skate with him? Was he...
Because he wasn't the best skateboarder. Never was.
Are you serious?
Serious.
I always assumed that he was, it was like Tony Hawk, no, him.
Not at all.
Bucky.
He was top 10.
Yeah.
Top 10 in the world for sure. At one point. Never a good contest skater. Never placed in a contest.
So I would say this, and I
mean, but he was like a cool guy and had an image, and that was the difference. With street skating, you could do stuff, and if you had an image, you had a creative photo, you found a spot that made a really good photo. You know, but I'm not trying to piss on his abilities. He had amazing abilities, but he was nowhere near the like a top five guy.
I'll tell this. I mean, I'm by the way, once again, I am not pissing on Kevin Hart, but not out of the group of guys that I knew starting out of New York. Definitely charismatic, but not the best comic.
Right.
Like you'd definitely go. I would pass on his comedy at times. I think he's gotten much better as a comic. I think he has a team of writers also that helps. And the bigger he gets, like. I saw his Shaquille O'Neal Cedric the Entertainer stand-up set. One of my favorite sets I've ever seen in stand-up. But it's, like you said, it's this like, cult of personality they have inside their head. They're like, oh, I'm gonna... Maybe it's like they look at everyone else and they go, I might not be the best, but I'm smarter than everyone in this fucking room.
I think you envision yourself, you create a vibe. Like, I feel like everybody I know that's a really big famous person, like the Madden brothers, there's a thing that they do all the time that makes them look good.
Oh, if I had a fucking brother, I'd be huge. Like a twin? If I had a twin brother, yeah, we would destroy.
You could be the Sklar brothers.
Oh, I look at the Sklar brothers and go, they're fucking sandbagging each other. How are they not the biggest? If I had a guy that could double my workload, I'm doing this by myself.
It's like the being Sklars a gay are, couple.
Yeah.
But your partner is just as funny as you and just as driven.
If Tom Segura and I were gay, we would be the moguls in this business.
You would
business.
Have so much money. Think about how much money you would save on not having kids.
Oh my god, and we wear this. I just gain weight and we wear the same size clothes.
No. Right. You could share hotel rooms on the road.
Oh, no. I often think how
cool. Oh, I know. Think of the money you'd save on just buying one house.
One Uber.
One house.
One limo.
Oh.
One helicopter, because you're getting a helicopter. You're fucking gigantic.
Oh god, yeah. Oh, this would be. I mean, my wife one and surfboard. His wife are just. They're just dead weight.
Yeah, no,
if me and Tom could just stomach blowing each other.
I want to agree with you, but I'm not going to do that.
If we could just stomach...
I know.
If we were like...
Gay couples, no kids, two incomes.
Yep.
I mean, it's like exponentially easier to live the high life.
One time I was hiking up Runyon Canyon, and I had my youngest daughter...
That's a video.
In a one of those outdoor strollers.
Oh, man, super dad.
Cranking. And I had my youngest daughter... In a backpack.
Fuck
and I'm,
off!
And I'm trying to lose weight. I'm... pushing up gangster. The hill, and three gay guys just smoke right past me.
Yeah.
And I go, that's an analogy for life.
Yeah, no, it is.
And then I got all these burdens that I'm pushing up a hill, and you know gay what, guys though? Are just,
That's like what the start of the show I was talking about, because I'm an alcoholic. I see people out, I'm thinking everyone else is drinking, and I'm not, and it's not really that's the case. You're seeing a bunch of gay guys that are all working together. Guess what? There's a ton of gay guys out there going out with a useless gay guy that doesn't do shit.
Why would you ever go out with not your dream man if you were gay?
Wait, what the fuck does it... Wait, why would you not go out with your dream girl that would never stop, like...
It's harder. There's a handicap when you're straight.
Are you saying women are handicapped?
I'm saying that there's a handicap when you're straight. You don't get to get what you want. You just gotta get what you can get. When you're gay, you get what you want.
How's that? Yeah, go ahead.
If you're gay, you just go, I want that, and I get that.
What? Wait, and if you're straight, how do you not just get that?
If you're straight, because there's other guys.
See, no. This is something that I can relate to, because I was married, and I'd made an accident. I mean,
Bless
my ex-wife. But when I was married to her, there were certain things that I wanted and I could not have. Because I did not think before I had a baby with her and married her, that was not the thing that I should have done. What I should have done, because you're reminding me of me a lot now. I feel like you got married because you were like, I don't want to be alone. Like, I need a team. Then you had a baby, and then you had two babies. Yes, it is. You're in denial. You're in denial because you're in hell. You're like, look, I really want to get that, but I can't have that because she's not going to let me have that. That's why you bring it up, like, when you're a gay guy, you can have what you want. Guess what? Single Bert Kreischer that didn't drop any loads in a uterus could have had whatever he wanted.
No.
But he fucking blew it.
Look. I've been now with chicks my to... whole life, and I've...
Yeah, right, you've never been single. You've never been alone. Gotcha.
No, that's not it. I, look, I we'll say there's guys listening to
this
right now.
That's why
you
go on the road. Oh, there's please, guys listening to this. Let's go. I get some time off without the kids and the fucking wife. And when I get out, and she can't see, I get any beer I want, any kind of beer I want. I'll take some fucking Molly. Fuck it, Justin Bieber's awesome.
There's guys that are listening right now that goes, there's the hottest girl that went to Florida State. I know, we all know who that is.
Yeah.
She didn't want every guy. She only wanted her guy. Yeah. So you went, okay, that's off the list. Second hottest girl. There's like a group of five of them that you go, it's a toss-up. But they all got guys. They're all off the fucking list. And then you're like, all right, now I'm down. I'm in the top. I'm in the lower 30. The 30 hot, third hottest girls, that group. And you're like, I can get that girl, but she's fucking, her eyelids come in tight to her nose. Man. And there's like a space behind it. That kind of freaks me out. And you're like, I don't like her. But then you're like, fuck it, I'll take the eyelids. You know, that'll be okay. That'll do. Ah, she's weird. Her teeth have a gap at the top.
It's cute when they have that.
Yeah, well, I didn't like it. But I was like, this is in the group of 30. Now, if you said to me, Bert, pick the one you want, I'd go, oh, I want the number one one.
That's a terrible pick.
Yeah, but
that's okay, that's the hardest price to pay.
But now, were you the single most attractive eligible guy at your school?
No, but if I was gay, I would definitely be fucking the hottest dude I want.
No, you wouldn't.
Why do you think that's
no, you wouldn't.
I'm fucking walking to a gay bar and
fucking,
like, I want him.
I'm bi. I can get any gay guy. I can't get every gay guy I want. When I go to the spa, all the gay guys want me because they know that I'm the straight
That's
guy.
That's what I'm talking about.
But I'm not the hottest gay guy you can get.
All the gay guys want you. That's the key.
Okay, well, let me reframe that. Rephrase that. That is he's a gay guy. That
see,
I
my math is working out.
Yeah, no, you're not. You're not working. You're not
if
working
I walk
out.
Into the steam
you're
room.
You're talking about getting a hot gay guy. It's not like working out to being a power couple. If you get a really hot ding-dong fucking bimbo gay guy,
yeah,
he's going to be sitting on the couch smoking weed waiting for you to come and going, let me see your phone. Did you cheat on anybody? Because you know you're fucking getting blown at the spa by other people.
Okay.
You got to get a hustling gay guy.
Well, that's what I picked with a woman.
You bought a hustling woman or you bought a bing-bo, you got a ding-dong?
I got the hustling woman.
Here's the difference.
Well, then what are you complaining about?
I'm just saying, if I was gay, I would... I don't know. I think I don't know. I don't know my
no,
my yeah, logic.
No, you don't make no. It is, no, you just I know you're digging a deep hole.
There actually is something to your argument, but it's not the bit that you're emphasizing. If you were not in a relationship, you could have more and better promiscuous sex if you were gay. I believe
yes.
that is true.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's true.
That's what I'm saying.
But I know a lot of gay couples that are yeah. like, we'll gladly, you know, hang out and blow you. I don't know too many married couples that are like. So, Jace, I was thinking maybe you could come over and fuck my wife.
Yeah.
I don't get that offer too much.
That's
but
what
in terms
I was saying.
Of partner, like making a power couple, I think you would find your level that we about you do about as well in the gay relationship world as you do in the straight relationship world.
Here you go.
Hold on. That's a very interesting statement. Be honest. No sexuality attached. Look at marriage as a business partnership because that's ultimately what it is.
Yeah.
No sexuality attached. If you were going to start a business, would you start it just baseline? Would you start it with a woman or a man? Starting a business.
A woman.
I'm picking a dude.
I would pick Kim Kardashian's mom.
Oh, I'm picking a dude, and I'm picking the guy that invented Tesla.
Yeah, but he's such a nerd. He's not fun.
Well, again, you're
I'm taking a fucking nerd.
You're assuming
I'm taking
once
a nerd.
Again that you get the absolute pinnacle of each field. And I'm saying with all due respect to both of you guys.
Oh, then I'm fucking Rod Dyrdek.
I think that we would both do exceptionally better. If you were married to Rob Dyrdek and I was married to Kevin Hart, we would be on fucking fire.
But guess
dude,
what?
And Rob came home and he was like, if Rob was like, I need a blowjob, I'd be like, no question, man. You killed it today.
Yeah.
Like, no, women don't look at them like that.
Yeah, well, I would be the top if I was with Kevin. It's interesting to see what position you would be with
I'm
Rob.
I'm definitely a top.
He just
no
said,
way.
You just, he oh, just gave
oh,
up
just
your bottom right
bottom.
There.
I did
you
give
just gave up your bottom.
Bottom. Oh, fuck.
He's coming home. And
he's coming home with a paycheck and I'm sucking his dick. Oh, what a fucking idiot.
You fucked yourself.
Okay, I'm the bottom. Fuck it. As
for,
long as he
to be in
teach,
that one, to
long
be
as
in
he
that.
Can teach me how to ollie.
But once again, assuming that if you change the nature of human partnerships and now it's more about a business relationship and less about a sexual one, that once again, you guys get the pick of the absolute litter and you get to be the top.
I picked
well,
bottom.
Well, he picked bottom. But yeah, I'm the egotistical maniac that thinks Kevin Hart would be interested.
But you seem like you want to be some sort of alpha bottom, because you do feel like you get to at least psychologically top Rob Dyrdek. And I'm saying, with all due respect, good luck with that person.
I think you're more of a Tom Segura couple, which is where we go back to, which right. means you and Tom are together, and you're a bottom, he's a top, mm-hmm. and you guys are power coupling.
Yeah, oh yeah, yeah, and he's like a project, a fixer-upper.
Yeah. Yeah. Mine would be like Opie.
He's got the funny eyelids.
You and Opie.
Or Joe Rogan.
I'm not getting Joe in this mix.
Right, because you know he hates me, don't you?
No. But there's no...
I knew it!
Joe would come home and open the door and he's like, I'm fucking you. And you'd be like, no! And go running around the house and he'd grab you and fucking put you in a jiu-jitsu move.
Yeah, see, I think if we go to the Grand, he's definitely going to be the top. But if we're standing up, I'm the top.
Okay.
Well, that sounds like a sexual relationship that never needs to get stale.
Right?
But it is odd that we pick... that it's set, this world's set up that we pick the opposite sex to start businesses with. That,
no, we don't.
Well, I challenge your premise that marriage is fundamentally a business.
Entirely business.
Explain.
My wife and I have a business. It is, we buy a house, so we own property together. We renovate the house. We have to look at the how much we can take out of the house, what we're going to put into the house. Hey, well, let's get a car. We got to figure that out together. What kind of car do we want? What can we afford? Hey, you need to do this TV show, or you should do that, or it's more like a business than it is a sexual partnership. I mean, we have sex probably 6 times a month, but man, we talk about business non-fucking stop.
Well, you're really a romantic couple.
Well, that's what marriage is.
You know, no, it isn't.
Yeah, it is.
Well, it's your marriage.
Yeah, no. Just the third component to me is the critical one, which is that I feel like I have more than a business or a sexual. I have an emotional partnership with my wife that far overshadows the bills.
Okay, I definitely have an emotional relationship with my wife. Glad but that's only because she put me in therapy.
Jesus, bud.
So your special is called Bert Kreischer, The Machine.
Yes.
And does this mean, do you retire your set after you do?
I would love to.
Does this mean the end of The Machine?
Nah, I'm sure it won't. Because there's people listening right now that are like, wait, what's The Machine?
I haven't seen The Machine.
I got involved with the Russian Mafia.
You did?
You never heard that story?
Nah.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'm like, not, I'm not relevant.
No.
Relevant. I thought that we might have talked about this when you were on the show earlier.
Yeah. We might have. I don't know. I think we ended up, the first time I was on the show, we ended up talking about the Van Wilder stuff, right. I think.
Yeah, that's what I'm familiar with.
Yeah.
But
yeah, I got involved with the Russian Mafia when I was in college and we robbed a train.
Cool.
It's a good story. It's on my special. It airs November 11th at 10 p.m. on Showtime, everybody.
Showtime.
Available on demand the following day.
Is it?
Yeah.
According to my notes.
Oh, shut the fuck up.
Yeah, you're huge.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. I like it. I like your TV show. I never saw it, but it looked like it was good.
Yeah, it was good.
Is it over?
I don't know.
I hope you get more. It looks like it was cool.
I want to do some other stuff. I'm doing a scripted show.
Yeah?
Yeah, you can be in that. Easy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we're shooting one. We're shooting it before the year's up. And then...
I love acting.
I have not acted in a while. I've just done this hosted stuff.
Yeah.
So it'll be fun. But I'm sure... But a lot... Interestingly enough, the show is very similar in essence to what I do already. So it'll be extreme crazy.
Don't have to stretch it too far as well?
I guess.
You're not going to be a doctor or anything in it?
No.
That's what I've always said. If you're gonna have me in a movie, like, don't push me to. You know, if you want me to be like a tough guy, because I've been pretending to be a tough guy my whole life, so I gotta work out. But if you want me to be like a doctor or like a Mexican guy or something like that, that's gonna be tough for me.
It'd be really tough. Yeah.
I may be a doctor, but I grew up in the barrio, and that doesn't go away.
It's gonna be tough. It's gonna be a stretch. But it's great to have you on the show. I wish you could come on the show more, but obviously, you know, you're linked with all these other comedians that hate me, so it's tough to have you on.
We look forward to seeing you next time.
Why don't I bridge relationships? Why don't I, want, like, not once a week, but every now and then I'll bring in a comedian you don't know, and I'll introduce you to him.
You're lying, but I would
say... No, I'll do it 100%. Right. You name the comedian, I'll come in, and then I'll also bridge the gap between Jason and the comedian.
Awesome. So November 17th, we will see you, Bert, and Kevin Hart.
You want a black comic? You want a black comic?
I do not know much about Kevin Hart. Could you introduce us to him?
I've always been curious.
Sure, I'll bring in Kevin.
What's with
Hart?
That Kevin Hart guy you keep bringing up? I mean, you're bringing him up. I don't know about him.
All I've heard so far is he did one of the best sets you've ever seen. So yeah. I'm sold.
Yeah, maybe we can help break him out.
I'll see what I can do. Yeah. You know what? I'm going to tweet him right now.
Now that we're in the podcast world, it would be good to be back on your podcast, but I'm sure that
I'd love to have you guys on my podcast.
We would be on there. I would drive there once again, and I would be on your podcast.
In a heartbeat.
We are available.
All right. I'll hit you guys up.
All right.
BertBertBert.com for all your tour dates. Please don't be a stranger.
I love you guys.
Yeah. Well, I love you, but, you know, I don't know.
No, I love you. When I sit sober, I'm going to text you and go, hey, we're still cool, right?
Fuck you, dude. Thanks
to Bert Kreisch for coming in. That was fucking awesome.
Baltimore, you can see him November 10th through the 12th at the Baltimore Comedy Factory. Coming up next.